The Green Hornet was the break Bruce had been seeking. A way for him to demonstrate his martial arts through the medium of television. He and Linda had married in August 64, and together with their baby son Brandon, moved to Oakland, California in May of the following year.
And as I understand, I think Bill Dozier went to one of the Kung Fu shows and saw him at the Long Beach Auditorium or something, and, you know, he said, there's Kato. It was a vigilante type thing, and to me, it was more like a James Bondian type deal that they were going to do. I don't think I met Bruce until the press party. Adam introduced us both, and we were there, and that's the first time I'd met Bruce, and we really didn't have much time to sit down and talk or anything else, but I liked him from the moment I met him.
He was constantly training, yes. He was very, very diligent in that he was always working out and training and always in motion.
He kind of ran people around the set nuts because he was always doing his kicks and this, that, and the other, and I remember a number of times I was standing there watching the thing, you know, like this, and I'd feel a whoosh. He had jumped up in the air and reached out with his toe and ticked you on the ear, you know. Well, that stopped when one of the grips was standing there, and just as he did it, he turned to the right, and the guy hit him in the jaw and dislocated his jaw.
He'd hit you in 10 different spots, and as a stuntman, you wouldn't know to grab your jaw and say, that hurt, or your stomach, you know. So the stunt coordinator did his best to slow Bruce Lee down, because the Western way they accepted is the old John Wayne method, where you'd reach from left field, tell a story, and hit the man. He'd like to throw 37 kicks and 12 punches.
If you design a part for somebody to fit into, who better than Bruce Lee? I mean, he was Kato, and, you know, the things that he did just set that whole thing aside, and I think made a heck of a show out of it.